everybody. This is DJ Ravenwolf. You're tuned in to the best of hair on KCLA FM 99.3 Los Angeles and around the world on KCLAFM.com and the best of hair radio.com as well. And in the past few months, you've heard me talk to quite a few girls. Megan was on the show last time talking about her life in the industry and getting out. And now she's a mom and she's got a job and she's doing great. And some of the emails I've gotten since that show have been from a lot of girls that seem to be in the industry that are, they feel like there's no way out. With the economy being as it is, there's a lot more women going to places like the Bunny Ranch and prostituting themselves just to pay the mortgage or to try to, you know, make ends meet of some sort. A friend of mine out in Las Vegas, Annie Lobear, has pointed out that there are a lot of houses along the strips that are being used for prostitution and sex trafficking and all kinds of stuff. And on the ballot this year in California, there's a proposition to help stop sex trafficking, to help bring to bear a lot of, it's more than a slap on the wrist for the pimps that are out there. This time they're going to be put in prison, hopefully. And there's a lot of things going on. So for all of you listening out there who may be in the industry trying to get out, or maybe you got out and you're just really struggling and having a hard time, I really wanted to bring somebody on who, you know, who knows what you're going through, who's been there herself. And it's taken an act of God just to get her on the show. She's so hard to get a hold of. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Crissy Moran on the phone with me. How you doing, buddy?
I'm good.
Crissy, I've read some of your stuff as far as, you know, what your background story is, and I know you've given it 1,000 times, but for some of the listeners that may not know who you are or maybe not familiar with your work or what you've done, could you give a little, just kind of a brief history about what you did? I think there was something that said you got into the industry because you were going through some kind of depression or something. I don't remember what the story was.
I'm not going to start at the beginning unless you want me to.
That's okay.
It's a long story. I mean, basically my childhood, I was never really felt like I belonged in a particular group of people. I never felt loved from my family. I didn't get a lot of attention growing up. And so my story was more of a search of love. And it didn't start in the sex industry. It started before I went into the sex industry, and I was like a serial dater.
Wow.
I had to have a man in my life. Pretty much my dad, you know, it goes back to your childhood.
Sure.
Well, for me, yeah. And, I never really felt love, so I found that in relationships with men. So I dated many different guys, and at the time right before I got into the sex industry, I had started online dating and meeting guys, like flying to like New York and stuff like that, which is really crazy to meet somebody because I really wanted to have a family and get married.
Yeah.
And my dating life in my early 20s was really rough. I would date one guy, break up, and I would already have another guy. Already, waiting to date me.
Wow.
After a lot of heartbreak, I ended up finding a modeling website, and I put my pictures up on the website looking for work.
Right.
I didn't know if I could get modeling work.
Right.
But whenever I started getting the emails, I didn't get anything about posing in a bikini or anything like what I was looking for, but I got a lot of emails about doing a nude shoot. And I said no for a really long time, about a year, to everybody who emailed me, or I wouldn't respond. But then at a certain point, I got to a really low point. I was having panic attacks and very depressed. And then I went through a breakup that really broke my heart, really badly, and just kind of put me in like the lowest of lows. And that's whenever I kind of, around the same time, I was tempted to do my first nude shoot, and I actually took the opportunity to do it. It was with a really good photographer who had shot like really beautiful women. So
right.
To me, it was flattering that he would choose to shoot with me, especially at that low part of my life.
Sure. When you talk about being depressed and stuff like that, do you I mean, looking back now, can you figure out what it was about your life that was, I mean, because not many people, hey, I'm having a bad day, let's go do this. You know, do you remember what it was? I've talked to about four or five girls that did porn out of spite. They were trying to get back at a boyfriend or get back at an ex-husband or somebody. And so they were doing it mainly out of anger. And you're basically doing it out of depression or something. Do you remember what it was at that time that you were going through?
I mean, I definitely think it was a search for love and you know, finding that acceptance in that industry kind of filled the empty spot inside of me.
Yeah.
And if I really want to look to the root of it, I could see that part of it probably was, you know, just to get a reaction out of my family.
Really?
So, I mean, yeah, like, I think so. I think, you know, when a child has been felt neglected most of their life and they're told, you know, from one parent, you know, my parents divorced when I was 14, so one of my parents was saying, you know, you need to be a virgin so that you get married, and I'm like, I listened to that from my dad, and then my mom's like, if you have sex, let me know so I can put you on birth control. I was very confused.
Yeah.
I think, you know, I was like so upset at my family, my parents, for not really being there for me, and I think it was first a little bit of shock value, you know. In the back of my head, I was like, yeah, you know, this is going to make them, you know, wake up and, you know, be like, I don't want you to do that. I mean, there was a part of me that, even in the online dating, you know, I flew to New York to meet a guy, and I was actually living at home at the time, and I was in my early 20s, and I just moved back home, and my mom said, you know, I said, I'm going to New York to meet a man. She's like, I don't think you should do that. And I said, well, you know, too bad, I'm going to do it anyway. And that's when she was supposed to start crying and say, you're my baby. I didn't want you to do this. I love you.
Yeah.
And it didn't happen. So I think a lot of it was for shock value, just to get them to care about me and to for them to say that they worry about me and love me.
Yeah. So basically you're really coming from a place of loneliness. Were you like an only child, or did you have brothers and sisters, or what?
No, I had a brother. When my parents divorced, he stayed with my dad, and I moved in with my mom.
Right.
And it was just really rough for me, and two different extremes.
Yeah.
Extremes. You know, my dad was, you know, he was drinking, and he was really hard to reason with. But he was always preaching, going to bars and preaching and getting shot at and stabbed.
Wow.
And, like, crazy stuff. But, it, you know, like, half of what he said was very offensive. He didn't know, like, it didn't even make sense. You know, it was kind of, you twist the verses and, you know, stuff
sure.
like that. And then,
sure.
you know, my mom gets remarried and doesn't really have time to sit down and talk to me about my day or any of that. You know, so it was two different extremes. And as a child, it's like hard to just feel like, I mean, it's hard when you feel like you're all alone. You can't talk to one parent because they're, you know, doing crazy things and they're not in their right mind. You can't talk to the other one because she's giving everything to her marriage. I felt really neglected.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So you go to your first shoot and you're going to, at that point, you're kind of feeling like, hey, people are paying attention to me. I'm getting some kind of reaction. At what point do you start getting into the adult films? Did somebody forward those pictures, or did somebody approach you, or how did you attempt all that stuff?
Well, in the beginning, I only did topless stuff for a long time, and I started a website, and I had, you know, maybe 100 members.
Right.
And, you know, they were, like, hardcore members, so, like, I did webcam shows and stuff. But eventually I ended up going out to L.A. to do a photo shoot, and that's where I met my manager. And when I met him, you know, I wasn't sure. I was just doing, well, I had progressed to doing full nude. So, you know, most of the girls that he shot didn't really do hardcore porn.
Right.
Not that he shot, but that he worked with.
Right.
So I'm sorry if my phone's beeping. I don't know if you can hear that.
Oh, yeah, okay.
He's trying to call me, but anyway, he didn't really book girls who did hardcore porn. He booked girls that you know, did the softer side or just did girl. So working with him, I kind of progressed to then doing girl stuff.
Right.
But he still didn't do boy call. I mean, this is in the course of like the first 3 years or so. I don't think I worked with men. And eventually, I ended up having a boyfriend who wanted to do movies together.
Yeah.
And that relationship was 3.5 years. And during those years, I guess the first 2 years, I probably didn't do anything with men. And then the next 3.5 years, I worked with him, and we did less than 10 movies, although, you know, online it says I did over 40 movies.
Yeah.
You know, I think people in the industry understand how that works. Basically, you shoot a scene, and they use it in several different movies, and then, you know, I did some stuff for fetish stuff, and they put every little thing I put on my page, which isn't really, wasn't even a movie, but just stuff for website stuff. Anyway, basically, he and I did less than 10 movies together, and I didn't work with any other men.
Yeah.
So, yeah, and during that relationship, it was a very abusive relationship. He kind of controlled everything in my life while we were together. So, you know, I didn't really enjoy doing scenes with him. He was really hard to work with.
Yeah.
And I didn't really like him very much.
Aw.
No.
Well, that's another thing I've heard a couple of girls talk about, that, you know, they had a boyfriend that they did scenes with. One of my friends from high school, she, back in the 80s, when we graduated 85, she started with burlesque, and then she became, somebody from Penthouse caught her up, and she was a Vivid girl for several years. But back then, it was a different industry. I mean, back then it was kind of like a badge of honor. Now it's like nobody cares. Her name in the industry was Alex Taylor, and she did a lot of stuff overseas. She did a lot of stuff here. But with her, it was just a different industry. It was a different story, but hers is a little similar to yours. She didn't really have that much of a bad experience. But the thing is, she knows, you know, things have changed. She did it completely for the money, and she did okay, but she married a guy, and they did, I think, 6 or 7 films together. But out of those 6 or 7 films, it went on the websites, it went in the magazines, it went all over the place. They make millions of dollars off of that one little scene, and you get, you know, a couple of bucks. So she was basically taken down the river, and yeah, they... A lot of girls that think they get married in this industry with a guy that does the same thing, it doesn't turn out good at all.
Yeah, the stories I know haven't turned out well. I mean, like, you know, we get in a relationship, they're swinging and everything else. It seems like the people I've known that had that kind of lifestyle really didn't last very long, and it became really volatile.
Yeah.
You know, drugs and stuff. You know, and I know several girls that I'm friends with have had relationships.
Yeah. So you get into the point where you see that the relationship is abusive and stuff. At any point during this time, I mean, it's still kind of an early stage, did you ever feel like this isn't for me? I mean, or did you just keep going with it? Or what was going through your mind when you're doing all these things?
Do you mean the relationship or the porn industry or both?
Just everything in life. I mean, you started out with being kind of lonely. You find some kind of recognition, but the guy is... really not good, and but you still continue, right?
Yeah, the first couple of years, you know, when I was still doing the soccer stuff, I had different boyfriends. So these guys that were in my life kind of, you know, would push me to do more. Even in my personal life, one of my boyfriends who I never worked with wanted me to be with a girl, and I didn't want to do it. I wasn't really into it. So I ended up doing it, and it was a bad night. But it was forced. I was kind of like forced to do it, like talked into it, and it was really awful. But you know, each guy kind of took me further down the road of doing more and doing more. But in this particular abusive relationship, it was almost like I didn't have much of a choice in what I did at that point in my life.
Right.
And I had given him all control, and. Part of the reason is I had only met him maybe a month before he moved to, before he was planning to move to California. And when he said he was moving, I was already attached.
Yeah.
And I was like, I'm coming with you. And it was the first time I ever left Jacksonville, Florida, where I grew up.
Yeah.
And I moved all the way across the country with an abusive man. And I was already an introvert. And I didn't really have friends. My family wasn't really around. So I was kind of trapped in my own home. He had an assistant that lived with us that would tell him everything I was doing.
Wow.
He was living a double life also. Like, he was doing other stuff, porn type stuff. What do you call it?
he was messing around.
You could call it gay for pay.
Yeah.
He was doing stuff, which I didn't even understand what he was doing. I thought he was doing stuff that he told me he was doing, but he was really doing more than what I thought.
Right.
Really weird. And he was basically living with somebody else, but lying, pretty much living with him, but also renting a house for me and his assistant. His assistant kept an eye on me. I couldn't go anywhere. My boyfriend would take my keys and hide them. He would break my cell phone. He would knock me out. I was a prisoner in my own home.
Wow.
And then the times when we would fight, it was hard to get away from somebody when they're, 220 pounds.
Yeah.
And I was only 100 pounds, and he's a grappler, so he would hold me and hold until I was exhausted.
Yeah.
And then by the time you're exhausting, you're fighting and stuff, you just kind of give up.
Yeah.
That flight.
Yeah.
The fight and flight, you're just over it. And it's like, okay.
Man.
Whatever. So, yeah, I wanted to get out of it. And there were times when I would tell people what was going on, particularly some friends of his, and told them, and they ended up telling him that I said that he was abusing me and that I had bruises and all this stuff. And then he just told them, I take medication for depression and I'm crazy.
Wow.
And so they believed it. And nobody would try to help me. And then there was, one guy in particular, he was an artist, and he would draw pictures of different models or porn stars. And I was one of the ones he would draw photos and pictures of. And he started coming to our house. He knew I was being abused. He was he was a smaller guy. Terrified as my boyfriend.
Right.
So when he would come over and hang out with me to try to help me, but he couldn't take me out of it. And even, times where we've been fighting on the side of the road, there was one time he goes, this guy pulls up in a Porsche because we're fighting in a parking lot. And he's like, do you need some help? And I'm like saying, yeah. And my boyfriend, he goes up, and he's huge, he's really muscular. He's like, you better get out of here. The guy leaves.
Wow.
One time I jumped out of the car and ran to a 7-Eleven screaming, call the police, he's going to kill me. And literally there was 10 people in there. Nobody did anything. They just kind of froze.
Wow.
My boyfriend came in, threw me over his shoulder and took me out of there and said, sorry, she hasn't taken her medication.
Wow.
He literally did not get out. And my family wasn't helping. My mom, we have a great relationship now, so I don't want to say too much.
Right.
Bad, but I called her and would tell her what was going on. She's like, you need to fly home. But she didn't understand that I couldn't. I couldn't get any money. I couldn't get in my car. I was trapped.
Yeah.
So the first year, I would say, I probably loved him. But after a year, I gave up. Because in the beginning, I was thinking I could help him. I was, codependent.
Sure.
I wanted to help him. I thought one day he's going to be like, oh, you're such an angel. I love you. You changed my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. After the first year, I kind of didn't like him. I always wanted to leave, and I was very depressed.
Wow. Well, I'm amazed. Yeah. That's hearing a lot of these stories, I'm amazed you guys are where you're at now, just looking back at all that stuff. Most of the listeners that I've got are kind of ignorant as far as what the industry is about or what it's like. We always see, what's on the cover of the magazines. We always see the foo-foo stuff. We don't really see the behind the scenes of what goes on. And there is a flip side to all of that stuff. A lot of guys think that the girls are sex maniacs, that they love what they do. They're making all this money and they're successful. Is that something you saw?
Well, yeah, I definitely, my fans, I had to make everything believable. That's how he's making a living.
Sure.
You know, that's part of it. You're selling that fantasy. That's
right.
What you do.
Right.
And, you know, I probably wasn't the best porn actress in the world, and I know that. I'm okay with that because I wasn't happy. And I think, you know, any of my friends who've seen my movies probably agree that I didn't look happy. yeah, I mean, like, what goes on behind the scenes, for me, like I said, I only worked on maybe 10 movies with a guy, but I've been on sets where there's guys, and, you know, for me, working with my boyfriend at the time, it was, you know, I had more control over what I did and what I didn't do, because the way that I started, I had already built up fan base on my own.
Right.
So I was making a decent income without having to do movies.
Right.
So when I did a movie, I wouldn't do a lot of stuff other girls do. I didn't do anal, I didn't work with other men. I was very pretty normal stuff.
Right.
I wasn't very vocal, you know, I was just like I didn't have to do that if I already had a fan base.
Sure.
However, I've been on sets when I was just working with girls that had guys on set, and I've seen, you know, how difficult, you know, it's been for some of the girls, and I've seen some, you know, some girls that probably people have heard of with alcohol on set, like drinking it out of their suitcase, putting it back, or doing drugs, or marijuana, or coke, and so I've worked with some girls that were kind of coked out and
right.
Stuff like that. Personally, I was very good at disassociating, so when I was working, I could totally, like, because when you're abused as a child, for a coping mechanism is to, you know, you kind of disassociate, you numb out, you don't feel anything, you're
sure.
Just kind of, like, looking at yourself from the outside view. So since it was my job, I'm thinking, what do I look like to the camera, you know, and I would put myself behind that, and that's how I would do my scenes,
yeah.
Make them believable.
Yeah.
So I would just put myself out there, and I didn't really feel connected to myself.
Yeah.
So I wasn't really present, totally present.
Right.
And though I didn't do alcohol or drugs when I did my shooting.
Yeah, you just kind of detach from yourself and you know, I guess basically hope that it gets over soon.
Yeah, I mean it's not fun doing sex in a movie. It's very hard work, actually. You have to hold positions that are very uncomfortable because the camera has to get in certain areas, and it's not natural.
Right.
You know, you're like, they come in, they're like, we're gonna do 3 positions. You know, to kind of lay it out, and it's just a job. It's not enjoyable.
Yeah. Well, that's one of the things, I guess, the myths that, you know, that's a sec, you know, they see the girl doing all this stuff and they figure she's this raging sex maniac and all that other stuff. And few realize that it's a movie, it's acting. It's the majority of the girls that I've ever talked to hated what they were doing. I mean, it was not anything. A lot of the girls that got into the industry in the beginning had some kind of an idea that this is easy, I can just have sex, make money, I'll be fine, and then find out this is nothing like they thought it was, but by that time they're either hooked on drugs or, you know, medication of some sort, and they're kind of trapped. They really are. They can't, you know, most of the agents or the girls have to have a driver because all the girls are messed up. They're on alcohol or drugs.
Yeah.
That can't drive.
I've literally seen, had friends that were in the business, and girls that I worked with, that I've seen them from day one when they came into the business, and before I got out of the business, I've seen them, their faces totally look different.
Yeah.
Look aged, due to drug use, and I've worked with girls who've been on stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, you see the powder in their nose or whatever, so I mean, I know for a fact, like, what, you know, what it's like.
Yeah.
You know, because I've been there, and even though I didn't participate in that part, I was still a part of that lifestyle that comes with that, you know?
Sure, sure. All right, Crissy, we're going to take a really quick break, and when we come back, we want to talk a little bit more about how you got out. That's the biggest issue right now, is a lot of these people trying to get out. There's a lot of organizations out there that help girls try to get out and help them when they do get out. So we want to try to get into that as well, and some of the work that you've been doing with Treasures and you know, basically on your own. You kind of moved out of L.A., so now you're really far away, man. All right, so we'll be right back, and hang on 1 second, guys, and we'll be right back after this. Okay, hang on, Chris, you gotta flip tapes around here. How we doing? We doing all right?
Yeah, we're doing fine.
Sweet, all right.
Audience.
Yeah. Well, we're not in church, so you can relax, man.
Yeah.
Churches are weird. They want to know, but they don't want to know, you know?
Yeah, they're weird. I just wait for the invitation. If they're going to ask the questions, I'll answer them, but if they don't, then I don't go there.
Yeah, when I used
to... I'll go to a certain level, and I, you know,
I used to give my testimony in some of the churches in the South, and my occult background was, you know, pretty rough, and so they, you know, especially around Halloween time, they always want me to tell my testimony. I'm like, well, you know, okay. And I remember this one preacher, he actually introduces me. I'm up on the stage, and he's got his arm around me, and he didn't really know anything about me. And so I started out with, yeah, I was, you know, 7 years I was a Satanist and all this other stuff, and he moved as soon as I said that, his arm went off of me and he went back, sat down, he got away from it. Like, it was a long time ago, I'm not like that anymore.
Yeah, sometimes it's just too much for, like, we don't realize it, for the, a normal person to have pretty much, you know, what people consider normal life.
Yeah,
like, whoa.
Yeah,
too much.
Well, they don't. Yeah. I don't think they expect the story to come out of you like it does. You know, they like, yeah. I said, a lot of people have a misconception of what the industry is or any of that stuff. And when they finally hear it, it's a big shot to the gut. I mean, I don't think. My old boss used to say, never ask somebody how they're doing because they might tell you. You know.
Yeah.
Oh man. All right, hang on 1 second. And we're back. This is DJ Ravenwolf. You're talking to Crissy Moran on the phone right now. We're doing a lot with the sex industry and the things that are going on in California right now, where there's an amendment on the ballot to basically bring harsher penalties towards sex traffickers. Matter of fact, a friend of mine the other night was on Rodeo Drive, and she texted me. She asked me, why am I seeing a gangster-looking guy with a five-year-old girl in heels? And because I know the area and because I know how this whole thing works, I said, how do you know that's his little girl? And it freaked her out, because child sex trafficking, especially in, you know, Koreatown and all this other stuff, is huge. There's a lot going on in L.A. that nobody hears about, nobody sees, and it's a problem. And so, and it's really weird. Nobody hears about it. Nobody sees it. So there's nothing that nobody does anything about it, because it's basically invisible. You were in the industry for quite a while, and how did you get out? I mean, what was the breaking point for you where you said, all right, I've had enough. This is it.
Well, I was in that one long relationship. I was in the industry total of 6 years, 3.5 years I was being abused. And that relationship was really drugs and difficult. That's the first time I was introduced to drugs. So he brought drugs into our home. So, you know, I never got addicted, but I had, I went through times where I did drugs for like maybe a week, and then I would stop for a few months. You know, so all that was like, a lot of things had worn on me in that 3.5 years. And then when I got out of that relationship, I was single for a year, but still looking. Like, I was dating and doing online dating again. It was very hard. I had, after I left that relationship, I moved away with our personal assistant. He was a makeup artist that moved in with us to help us do our own production.
Right.
So, you know, he knew I was being abused. He was the first person that tried to save me and the last person. So he did save me. We moved to L.A. because at that point we were living in Vegas. So he and I moved to L.A. And I lived with him, you know, doing the online dating thing. He would come home. I mean, he told me stories that I don't even remember. But, I mean, there were times when, you know, one time when he came home and I had taken a bunch of pills. And he came and I was just, like, I was out.
Wow.
He said, he got me up, he put me in the bathtub, gave me a bath, and he said I was technically not to call the ambulance. I don't even remember, but when he tells me the story, he's crying.
Wow.
It was, like, really hard for him. So the year that I was single was extremely hard because I was trying to find somebody to be with. And then I ended up meeting a guy that I met from online. And we lived together for a year and 8 months. So that was the last part of my time in the industry.
Mm-hmm.
During our relationship was the time when I got the most, I had more fans than ever when I left the industry. And
right.
That time of my life, I was getting hair extensive. I started doing all the stuff the other girls were doing, getting my lips done and, you know, all the fillers and all the stuff. So I was creating this, like, fantasy
mm-hmm.
woman. And pretty much the beginning of me being in the industry was very natural, except for, you know, I had implants. But other than that, like, I didn't mess with my face at all.
Right.
And then at the end, I was doing all this stuff, and I was getting more fans, and I was working out really hard, my body changed. And when I left, I was at the top. I was at the top of my time in the industry. I was more known. And what broke that, what took me out of that industry was my boyfriend at the time. I was with him a year and 8 months, and I was always really insecure about him looking at other women, or, you know, and then I would go back to my childhood and remember the stuff that my dad would say about lust, and there were verses that I knew by heart about lust, like looking upon a woman with lust, you've already committed adultery in your heart.
Right.
So all of this stuff that I learned as a child, because I wanted to get married, I wanted to go to church, I wanted to quit the industry, I wanted us to do something like real estate together, or,
yeah.
you know, something like that. And every time I would bring it up, he would laugh at me. And anyway, so I didn't work with men, you know, after the other boyfriend.
Right.
I still worked with women because it was a way to make extra money. But since I didn't work with men, I know this is going to sound really crazy, but I didn't want my boyfriend looking at other women because I wasn't looking at other men. And to me, it made sense at the time.
Yeah.
You know, I had guys lusting after me, but I wasn't lusting after any guys, so therefore I wouldn't want him to do that. But during our relationship, there were times when he would go out of town to work on TV shows or whatever because he was an actor or stunt guy. So I would always say, don't go to a strip club, or, you know, I was always with him 24/7, so when he left, I was scared that he was going to do something like that. And what happened is he went to a strip club, and I had called him, you know, he called me the night that he went, and there was music in the background, and I was like, where are you? And he was drunk, and he was saying stupid things.
Wow.
He lied to me about where he was. He said he was at TF Chang's, like, at 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm like, no, you're not. So I basically looked up his hotel online and realized it was right across the street from the strip club.
Wow.
Which I knew. And when I found out he was a strip club, it broke my heart because I'm like, wow, I've worked so hard these 6 years and to found a good guy, but I can't keep him. It's not going to keep us. I'm not enough for him. No matter what I did, as hard as I worked out, as pretty as I tried to make myself, I still wasn't enough for him.
Yeah.
So that reality just really hit me with a ton of bricks, and I was just like, wow, you know, I just kind of like gave up, and I, you know, got off the phone with him after he admitted the next day to go into the club, and I like fell to the ground, and I was just like crying
right.
so hard, and just like, wow, it doesn't matter what I do, I'm never going to be enough for anybody, and, you know, I'm like, you know, read these lists online where it says, like, who are the beautiful porn stars? And I'm like, in that list, and still, I'm not after this guy. Like, you know, what does it take? And during that time, that night, I cry out to God, and I was just like, you know what? You're real. I need to know it because I haven't felt your presence in my life since I was a little girl.
Yeah.
You know, I've been abused by men. I've been in the porn industry. I had this false sense of value. And that's only being found in my sexuality and my looks. It's all superficial. So, I just let it all out. And then a couple days later, my boyfriend invited me to come to the set of where he was working. He was really desperate at the time to make our relationship work.
Yeah.
So I was really reluctant, but I ended up going out there after a couple days of him asking me to come. And by the time I went out there, I had already grieved the relationship. I wrote down pros and cons of why I should be with him. I thought he was a good guy. He basically was. He's better than anybody I've ever been with. But the negatives were higher than the why I should be with him. So I already, you know, made peace with that. I went out there and I was hanging out on the set of the show, and one of the people on the set got a text message, and he started passing his phone around, and he showed it to my boyfriend, and I was watching, you know, everybody was standing in a circle, and they were, you know, making comments, and I was like, what is that? He said, oh, it's his wife, and she's topless. It's a topless picture's wife, or something stupid like that. And
yeah.
I got so, like, on fire inside. I'm like, this is what who he's around?
Wow.
You get people like this? And I was like, wow, you know, I'm sure everybody here knows who I am, knows what I've done. But I didn't know for sure. But I found out the next day, I was there for like 2 days. The following day, he was working, and one of these guys, we were in the circle talking, and I said, I did speak out against it. I said, I would hope that when I get married that my husband would not pass around pictures of me nude. And I did this knowing that he's done this. He'll email my pictures out to his friends.
Wow.
Like, I already knew he did that. But I didn't know that he would mix mainstream people with, you know, and send pictures of me to people in mainstream, you know, TV shows or whatever.
Yeah.
But I found out the next day when I was talking to some guy on set. He was just like, asked me what I did for a living. And I said, I do modeling. He asked what kind of modeling. And he said, bikini stuff, you know, Hawaiian tropics. I threw some stuff like that out there. And he wasn't going for it. So he kept pressuring me. And I finally said, I did porn. And he said, I already knew that because your boyfriend's already talked about it and been showing pictures to everybody.
Wow.
And then I was just like, great. You know, how... I tried to hide that in my personal life.
Yeah.
I didn't want people to know that.
Yeah.
Unless they were already in the industry, then I felt like at home. But I didn't want other people to know that.
Sure.
And it really, like, it hurt me. And then as I was talking to this guy, he's like, let me ask you something. And he goes, do you believe in God? And that, to me, I knew at that moment that God was using him.
Yeah.
He asked me. I asked for a sign, and I knew that was the sign. And I was like, I thought it was the weirdest question. Nobody has mentioned God to me in years. And I talked to boyfriends about, you know, God, and they don't really talk back, you know. So I was just like, wow. And he's like, and I said, yeah, I do believe in God. And he's like, you know, basically he told me that God loves me and that he, you know, wants me to change my life. And, you know, what he did. You know, told me the gospel, what he did, you know, on the cross.
Sure.
Gave me some life sense, and that I could be washed clean, start all over. It sounded so great. I was like, I want to accept him back into my heart.
Right.
You know, like, I was saved when I was 11 years old, but after all that happened in my life, kind of lost touch with God, and this was like, I knew that God was speaking to me through this guy. So
yeah.
We went outside and prayed, and I decided to change my life at that point. And later on, my boyfriend and I, we went back to our hotel room, and he's like wanting me to lay in bed with him. I'm like, you don't understand. I decided to change my life. I can't sleep in the bed with you anymore. And I actually didn't even want to because I was so over that relationship. in there, you know, I'm like, why go and lay in bed with a guy who's probably thinking about other women anyway?
Yeah.
So, from that point on, I quit the business. The business didn't find out until later because I didn't know how to tell people that I left the industry. So it was like a month or two later that it actually came out publicly.
Man. So you it wasn't really an easy transition for you. You kind of went through some rough stuff. And for those of you listening that you know, maybe you're going through a similar situation, there is a way out. You know, you don't have to be in a lifestyle that you don't agree with. You don't have to be with somebody that you don't agree with. That if you know in your heart and you know in your mind that this is wrong, this isn't where you need to be, there's a way to get out. And if you're having a hard time, there's a lot of organizations that will help you get out. And you know, there's no shame in reaching out to these people like Treasures. And there's a bunch of them. I think in Florida they have Beauty from Ashes. There's a lot of organizations. So, Crissy, how did you meet up with Treasures? How did you, you know, how did that relationship come about?
Well, I was referred by somebody else to Treasures. I lived in L.A., somebody gave me their information. I found out about Harmony. I called her, talked to her, prayed with her. You know, this was in the earlier days of Treasure, so I had access to Harmony personally. You know, now Treasure's grown so much, so Harmony's still mentoring me, but
yeah.
We have a lot of people who also are trained to work for Treasures in that same manner. But she just kind of came alongside me. When I first left the industry, I was in total shock. I mean, my whole identity had been stripped away.
Sure.
You know, I didn't have hair extensions anymore. I didn't have nails. I didn't have tans. I gained weight. I had cystic acne. Like, it was like major post-traumatic stress
that
I was going through. And so it was really good to have somebody that I could talk to about these things and you know, that was praying with me, even though, you know, I had made the decisions to change my life, but I was, like, real confused about everything. Like, where do I go to church? You know, who am I going to be able to talk to about this? So I was really thankful to have Harmony and Treasures at that point in my life.
Well, that's one of the things, too, that a lot of the girls that want to try to go to church, and I've had this story many times where even trying to get a job where somebody doesn't recognize you for what you did or what you did online, there's a lot of I've been through a lot of rough stuff where I really have a mistrust of churches these days. But there are a lot of predators in the church who, you know, in fact, recently in L.A., there was a couple of people that claimed to be pastors. They dated a porn star and they ended up shooting her and killing themselves. A lot of really weird stuff goes on. How do you find a church that you feel safe in? I mean, you must have gone to a few of them because you go and you sit there and you feel like everybody's looking at you. You know? Because you're in an industry where you're being abused. You're only there for whatever reasons, but you know, you're trying to get your life back. You're trying to find Crissy again. You're not, you know what I'm saying? I mean, it's got to be a weird feeling or a weird position to be in.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, in the beginning, I went to church with Harmony a couple times, or went to events at her church. And I liked it. It was different from the churches that I grew up in. You know, the music's happier. People are, like, you know, standing up with their hands in the air. I wasn't used to all that. I was raised in a Baptist church, so it was quite a bit different, so I didn't quite feel at home.
Right.
But, you know, after being out of the industry for a while, I started dating again.
Yeah.
And I dated a guy who went to another church. I started going to that church. It was a little more traditional, but with the same music, but people, you know, weren't really putting their hands in the air and stuff. And that became my church just because he went there. So he wanted me to get involved in telling my story and stuff like that. So he really encouraged it, even though at this church, people weren't open about stuff like that. But
yeah.
I got to know the young adult pastor in talking to him and praying with him every time I went to that service, which was on, Tuesday night. So I would tell him about my story and what I was doing. And he believed in me, and he He thought it was a great thing. He really liked that I was being transparent. And, so I kind of started feeling like that's a good church to get started with. And then eventually I started going to another church that was a really good Bible teaching church and talking to the staff there and they know my story. And, it's hard because you think that you're going to be judged.
Yeah.
And people are harsh and they do judge.
Yeah.
But the thing is, you can't let what people think get you down, especially if you're finding your identity in Christ, because, we've all fallen short. We all, have done things in our past.
Right.
None of us are perfect. And it's just, people are going to judge you because it's human nature. You just got to let go of that and do what you need to do.
Yeah.
And you will find community. It's just sometimes it takes time, and sometimes it takes time for you to be able to trust people in order to let them even in, And that's for me. I just moved to Houston, and I'm engaged. I lived here, so I moved here, and I'm at the point where I'm starting all over again with a new church.
Right.
The pastor knows my story. His wife knows my story, and I don't think anybody else does. And I'm like, okay. I need to figure out when's going to be the, right time to tell these women, or, I'm trying to figure all that out again.
Yeah.
But I know that I haven't done anything that's in God's eyes worse than what anybody else has done.
Right.
A lot of people just have been with a lot of men and haven't done it on camera.
Right.
So, I know, in God's eyes, it's all the same. So.
When after you got out and even though you're in church and you're doing all these things, did you ever have a moment of weakness where you felt like going back into the industry or did you basically make your mind up that was done?
Well, I knew I wasn't going to go back in the industry, but there was a part of me that was just like, I needed to make more money, and it was like torture not to be able to afford the things that were my identity. You don't really know till you leave, but to not be able to ever go to a plastic surgeon again or get your hair done, the things that you find your identity in is difficult.
Yeah.
So in the beginning of me leaving the industry immediately, within a month or two, I got several calls from really the top names in the business that wanted to work with me, either work do a girl scene with me, or I would work for their production, or, and it was like, I totally knew that it was just, temptation to go back into the industry and where it was coming from, and I stayed really strong and firm in what I was doing because my heart had changed.
Yeah.
And there was no way I was ever going to go back.
Right.
And I knew that. So it didn't matter who wanted to work with me.
Yeah.
I said no.
Yeah.
And
for those of you listening, we're talking with Crissy Moran. And for those of you that have written in about your particular situation, basically you're going to have to make up your mind to just get out, walk away. I mean, the industry doesn't care. They will replace you in a heartbeat with some other girl or guy or whatever. They don't care. It's these people, it's a business, you're basically their meal ticket. And if you walk out, they're going to treat you like crap. Trust me. While you're in the industry, you're their buddy, you're their friend, all this other stuff, but they don't care. They'll probably entice you with all kinds of things to try to stay in the industry or bring you back into it, but it hasn't changed at all. There was one girl that got out, and she was in it for a long time. She did a lot of, for those listening, Gonzo films, where she was just being abused. They would electrocute her. They were doing all this nasty stuff to this girl. And she went back into it. I'm like, it hasn't changed. It's still the same nasty stuff. You're going to die. If you don't get out of there, you're going to die. Your body can only take so much. I've known one girl that's been trying to have a baby. She's lost, since I've known her, I think she's lost about 4 babies because her body just can't sustain a pregnancy. She can't handle it. So for those of you listening, you honestly, look at what your situation is. And it might be hard getting out, but it'll be a hell of a lot better than what you're doing right now. And, I mean, especially with the diseases that are out there where one day you could catch HIV and, you know, there's no cure for any of this stuff. Right now in the industry, there's a big outbreak of syphilis, and that's another disease that can kill you. It basically put the industry to a halt because everybody was freaking out. You know, you're doing something that could basically, you're taking your life into your hands. And for girls like Crissy and a few others that have gotten out, there's hope. I mean, if they can do it, you can do it. You just have to make your mind up. And I think really the key is to hook up with people that will be there for you. Like you said, Dusty, Harmony's like your mentor. There's a lot of girls out there. Is there a website that they can reach Treasures at out here in L.A.?
IamATreasure.com. And can I talk about what Treasures does?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, Treasures is we have a support group for women in the sex industry. You don't necessarily have to be out of the industry to be a part of our group. You know, we still have women who are dancing and that are in the group, and you know, whatever, they still come every week because it's a good place to get support,
right?
And to feel like you belong and to be able to vent about what you're going through. And it's a very safe group. And we have like a professional therapist that leads the group. I actually worked for, I was employed by Treasures. Of course, I moved, so not anymore.
Right.
But I worked with the women in the support group. As you know, I was the face of the support group. I would welcome the women in. I would unlock the office. I would make coffee and talk to the women, check up on them, email them, keep up with their lives. And I still do. I'm actually, I've been here a month, and I'm still doing the same thing. I'm just doing it on Skype.
Right.
So I check up on all my ladies, and it's just been really healing. And the girls in the group are so awesome. I mean, it's not a catty place. There's no drama. People just talk about their lives, like what they're going through with their families, how they are afraid to tell them, how they're having a hard time getting jobs, you know, and all that stuff that you can talk through, and it's just, it's really healing. We don't push our faith on anybody,
right.
But it is a faith-based outreach support group, so there will be, prayer, but nobody is forced to do anything they don't want to do. If you don't want to pray, you don't have to pray, but
right.
They're still going to pray, we're still going to pray. And then Treasures also is an outreach. So we've gone to the strip clubs. You go to all the strip clubs in L.A., giving out gift bags that have, like, earrings and lip gloss. And there's a card in there that says, "You are loved, valued, and purpose."
Yeah.
And it has the Treasures information. So what we do is we don't track down people to go to get help. We extend the invitation. It is up to the women to make that choice. So there's no pressure. If somebody listening wanted to get help, you can go to our website, IamATreasure.com. I'm looking at the site. I'm trying to see how you get to the part where you get help. Okay, so at the top of the page, there's a link, and it says Dancers and Industry Girls Only. And if you click on that, it'll take you to there's a list of resources, and then you can put your contact information in, and it'll say send me an information on support group, or on peer mentoring, or on resources, and when you do that, then we'll send you a gift in the mail, and then information on those things, because we also do peer mentoring. So if it's somebody that just wants to talk to one person in their local, then they can just talk to that one person.
Okay.
And, and do it that way if they don't want to be part of the group.
Very cool. All right.
So, and the main thing that we do is we empower women to make their own choices, and when they're ready to do it, and there's no pressure, and we just want the women to know that they're loved, valued, and purposed, and to find true happiness in their lives.
Yeah. And it's never easy. Change is never an easy thing. There's always going to be a bit of a struggle, but, you know, there's no such thing as a victory without a battle. You're going to go through some things, but at least you'll have somebody there to help you through it, because, you know, going through it alone doesn't always work. It's rough.
Yeah. When I first There were times when I needed help, and there's times when I pushed it away. I was like, okay, I need a break from this. Like, I'm not able to go all the way through with this. And, you know, and I would like not talk to anybody from church, not in a mean way, just like, I was confused. I needed to figure some stuff out on my own. But treasure's always there when you need them.
Right.
So it's a very good ministry. And, you know, I actually was employed by Treasures, and, you know, I really just love what they do.
Very cool. And for those of you listening, Chrissy's engaged. She's going to be married pretty soon, which, you know, that's amazing. A lot of the girls that I've talked to that are in the industry, they have a massive hatred towards men, and you're just the opposite.
I can tell you more about that story if you want me to.
Yeah, that's kind of an interesting deal, because there's a lot of girls that, you know, I think they want that family, they want those things, but for a lot of them, it's like looking through the looking glass. It's a fantasy for them that is probably never going to happen, and they just feel like whatever their situation is, that's the way it's going to be. And there's that story that I've always referred to in the scriptures about the prodigal son, how he got, you know, stuck with his head in a pig trough, and he's realized, I don't have to live like this. I can go back home. I'll take the lowest job I can have, and I'll be okay. But for a lot of folks, they don't get that realization. They figure this is the way life is. This is how it's going to be. And when I was living on the streets and when I was homeless, that was a revelation given to me. I don't have to live like this. You know, I'll take a $5 an hour job. I don't, you know, whatever it is, I'll get myself out. And the reason I do a lot of these shows is because when I was on the streets out here, there were a lot of churchy people that just pretended I didn't exist. I mean, I was invisible. The only person that helped me was a prostitute on the street who, it was about 11 o'clock at night. It was cold, and she asked me if I had any place to stay. I said no. And she said, well, just stay right there. I was sleeping under a tree over here by Osh on Sunset Boulevard. And she came back with this great big coat. It was like a parka, but it was, for me, it was like a sleeping bag. It felt so good to have something warm. And then during the day, I met up with her again. I don't know how we found each other. She was coming from an opposite direction. And she said, are you hungry? I'm like, well, yeah. And she had this great big plate of Chinese food that she couldn't eat. So she gave it to me. I'm like, man, of all the people on this street, you know, it was a prostitute that reached out to me. She was more Jesus than most of the people in church ever were, you know. And so the reasons I do a lot of these shows is my way of giving back, because I know there's a lot of girls out there. I see them at night. I have a weird sleep schedule. I'll get up at 2 o'clock in the morning and I go to Food for Less down the street, and there's girls all over the place. I had a couple of Bibles from the XXX church that I given to the girls, and you know, it's when you tell them for the first time that somebody loves them, you see their eyes light up like it's the first time they've ever heard that. And it's an amazing deal. So for those of you listening, if you want to get out there and get out of the industry, go check out Treasures. Check out, there's a lot of organizations. I don't know what part of the country you're from, but if you send an email or something like that, maybe we can find an organization in your area to help you. Chrissy,
Treasures actually has a network too. So if they wanted to look on our website, mm-hmm. they could find something in their area as well.
Very cool. For those of you listening, we're talking with Crissy Moran, and like I said, she's engaged, and she's going to get married pretty soon, which is amazing. I was married once, and that was enough for me. I don't mind doing it again, but it's like, oh, man. Anyways, you're a brave girl, buddy. Tell me about the engagement. Now, how did you meet the guy? And he lives out in Texas, and you're out here in L.A., so how did that all come about?
Yeah, well, first I want to say, I did date a few guys in the Christian world.
The Christian industry, yeah. Yeah.
I don't know why that popped in my head. I guess I'm talking about the sex industry. But, so I did date a few guys in the Christian world, and, you know, of course, none of those worked out. And, you know, for women who are just coming out of the industry, it's really hard to date somebody because you don't really know people's motives.
Right.
You know, it's really difficult to date somebody at church who has the right motives and their heart's in the right place. But however, I started talking to my fiance in May of 2011. And at that time, I was in a place spiritually where I was making some big choices.
Right.
And one of the big choices was I felt like I needed to take a fast from dating. And I had never done it before. So I decided to do a 6-month fast from dating. And that also included spending any time with any guys, that, not in a group.
Right.
I thought I could not do it. I was like, this is going to be so impossible. I used to live with men. When I was, the last 6 years, I haven't lived with any men, but I've had relationships where I'm with them, with boyfriends all the time. So I decided to do the fast. I had just met my fiance online. We have a mutual friend that lives in L.A., and our mutual friend, my fiance, had helped him out with some issues he was going through. He was a drug addict, and he was coming out of that kind of lifestyle. So my fiance had actually lived in L.A. for a while, and, he's kind of like a brother to this guy. So we actually met on Facebook, but we have a mutual real-life friend, so it wasn't quite like dating online. And we were friends. We weren't even dating. And when I decided to go on my fast, it was like a month after we started talking on the phone. But, I prayed a lot. I was very prayerful in what I was going to do, what I was doing, and how strict I was going to be for my fast. But I decided not to spend any time with any guys on the phone, email, any of that stuff, except for this guy, because, he lives in Texas, so what's he going to do, right?
Yeah.
it only took a couple months, and I was just in love with him, even though I hadn't met him in person.
Yeah.
So I was just like head over heels. He didn't know it. And he wasn't like that with me yet.
Wow.
But I was like, this guy has the best character, and he had the past, just as crazy as mine, and he's overcome it. And he had been, he changed his life 8 years ago.
Yeah.
He was on a major recovery path as well. And where his path met up with mine, it was just a great place, because those 6 months, he and I did Bible study on the phone.
Right.
We talked about things. I asked him to never tell me, give me compliments like you're beautiful or any of that while I was on my path.
Yeah.
That's kind of presumptuous, I was used to that, and I didn't want to hear that. I just wanted somebody to give me real compliments. And so during those 6 months, I fell for him.
Yeah.
I couldn't wait to meet him. He came, as soon as my 6 months was up, he came to L.A. to meet me. He was here, he has friends here, and so we hung out, almost every day. He was here for, 10 days. And I really, just really liked him a lot. I was crazy about him. But he wasn't crazy dating.
Yeah.
He wasn't even going there. And I was just like, wow, he doesn't see me that way. But the more I knew about his character, the more he, was meeting me in the right way, the right places. I just wanted to be with him. There was nobody else I wanted to be with. And I prayed about it. And I was just like, I want to marry this guy.
Yeah.
So, what happened after 6 months, he went back, and I felt like God was telling me to take another 3 months off of dating.
Yeah.
So, it's something how do you know if God's telling you something? Oh, it's totally against everything that I know.
Yeah.
So I knew that wasn't my choice. So I went another 3 months, and then I went out to Houston, and I did a couple of speaking engagements out there, and he came to those, so we got to hang out a little bit. On Valentine's Day, I was out there doing a speaking engagement, and at that time, after I was done, we had a talk, we went and hung out, we were talking, and he asked me to be in Valentine, and that's when we started dating. So, it was February of 2013, we got engaged in July, but we kind of, I guess it was more of a courtship. We know each other, we're best friends. He knows everything about me. You learn a lot about somebody when you only talk to them on the phone for,
Yeah.
for 9 months. So, you know, we know each other very well. So now I just moved here a month ago. So I moved here last month, and now we're dating.
Yeah.
We're engaged. We're actually dating. We're learning each other. We're learning, you know, we have some things that we disagree on. We're very extreme in some things. Like, he's total opposite of me in some ways. But then we're some of the stuff, we're on the same page. I'm learning how to communicate in a healthy way. It's really hard.
Yeah.
Really hard. But it's so worth it. But, you know, like, the last 6 years has been just growing and growing. You know, I've been growing in different ways. And one of the things that I have found, you know, that I have found that I believe is that you have to be the kind of woman or man that the person that you want to date is going to be attracted to.
Exactly.
And if I was all falling apart in a wreck and, you know, still in the place where I was in the beginning of my journey, I wouldn't have an amazing guy like this. I would have the guys that I dated in the beginning.
Yeah.
We're not marriage material. So you have to work on yourself, because you're only going to keep attracting the same kind of people over and over again, you know?
There was a, well, psychologically, there was a thing that we talked about in our, you know, in our courses and stuff, where basically a little girl, from the time she's born to the time she's 5 years old, whatever man is in the house at that time, that's what she will most likely marry when she gets older. So if that guy is a loving, caring person, she will find a loving, caring person. But if, you know, he's not, she's going to gravitate towards some other things. The other thing is that, you know, we basically attract to ourselves those kinds of people that we are most like. If you like to go out and drink and party and get laid, then you're going to attract those kind of people that want to go out and party, get drunk, and get laid. And they are not marriage material, so you can't get mad at them when they don't want to marry you. So if you want to, if you want Mr. Right, then you better become Mrs. Right. You know, you have to work on yourself so that you'll attract that kind of a person. And again, it takes some, you know, work. It takes some basically reinventing yourself, you know. It's all about decisions and choices. I mean, you through the listening to your story, several times, I decided I'm going to do this, and I decided I'm going to do that. I'm going to fast from guy. I mean, this is a girl that would date every guy and stuff, and had to have a guy, and then she's like, "No, I'm going to quit for 6 months." Dude, that's impossible. I don't know how you did that.
Yeah, I can't believe it. And I've been abstinent for really, like, longer than that. So, and through this, I found real freedom. I figured out what things I like to do, what things I don't like to do. I never really knew all that when I was with men, because I would assume their identity. I would just become, you know, their perfect match. I was very submissive. And so if they liked to, you know, go hiking, oh, I loved it too.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
And now I know, truly know, after being alone, who I really am, what I like to do, and find my own identity.
Yeah.
So I think that's important, to take some time off of dating, because I know a lot of the women that I know who are in the industry were just the same way. They have to have somebody to love them all the time.
Well, that's,
you know,
that's part of the industry mold. You're in front of a camera, and you are whoever they want you to be. And if you're in it for any long period of time, you get swallowed up by that person. You know, that you get people like Tanya, who for years that was Jersey Jackson. It's not Tanya. It's somebody else. When you get out of the industry, you have to figure out who you are. You got to find yourself again. You got to, you know, that you've got that fantasy person in front of the camera, and then the person you go and, you know, go home to every day. I mean, you got to find yourself again, and it takes some work. It takes a decision to say, look, I need to be alone for a while, man.
Yeah, I mean, that was, like, very healing for me, and it gave that space for me to grow.
Yeah.
And learn what kind of a man I want to be with.
Yeah.
And make boundaries, safe boundaries, where I'm not letting every single guy come into my apartment. They don't deserve to be inside of my apartment.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
And so that was part of my past. You know, no guys were coming into my apartment even to watch a movie with me.
Yeah.
And the more boundaries you make, the better you're going to feel about yourself, because you're making healthy choices that, you know, are going to make you feel more secure and more, you know, and it will attract the right kind of guy. And I know it's like so foreign, probably what I'm seeing to most people who are listening.
Right.
But it really was a healing time of my life. I mean, I needed that.
Crissy, baby, thank you so much for coming on the show. I was begging you for a long time to come on here. There's just a lot of people that are out there that are hurting, and I think, you know, listening to your story and listening to, I consider it a success story, because you're coming out in a healthy way and you're doing well, man. I know it's not easy. You've been getting your share of struggles along the way, but you know, I really got to hand it to you. I love you, buddy.
Thank you.
And give Prudence a hug, too, man.
I will. She actually lives with my fiance, so
aww.
I don't get to see her all the time, but it's all good.
Yeah, man. All right, Crissy, thank you so much for coming on the show. And is there anything you'd like to say before we sign off?
No.
Okay.
I think that's it.
Okay. All right, buddy. Thank you so much for coming on, and I'll get this show out to you as soon as it's done being edited, and thank you so much for talking to me.
You're welcome.
All right. Thank you so much. Bye-bye. And that's Crissy Moran on The Best of Hair. And again, for those of you who want to check out Treasures, you go to www.iamatreasure.com, and they can help you with a lot of different things, especially if you're not from L.A. Maybe you're in Florida. Maybe you're in other parts of the country. Check them out online, and maybe they can help you, and maybe they can refer you to an organization in your area. This is DJ Ravenwolf from thebestofhairradio.com. We'll see you guys all again real soon, right here on The Best of Hair.